Raise your hand if you've come to God's house today to see Jesus. I have. Bible says where two or three are gathered in His name, there He will be among us. Now, I'm not a quick counter, but I'm going to guess there's more than two or three, all right? And so we're here to see Jesus. We want Him to be welcomed here. We want Him to stop by our place. We want Him to notice us and enjoy His time with us. Amen? And we want to lift Him up. That's why we are here. Let's pray. God, our desire is to desire You. We love You. We thank You for saving us, for changing our life. Lord, thank You for taking a sinner like me and having compassion and adopting me as Your child. God, help me to be a good son. Help us to be good children. Lord, work through our life, outflow from our life, that others may see You. Open our eyes, Lord, that we may see You, and open the eyes of those that we come in contact with, that they may see You as well. Be with us. We love You, God. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
As you sit down, look to your neighbor and say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus.
Absolutely.
On the rooftops of a million church buildings, on the flags of nations, and on a thousand logos, a cross can say, I will keep my promise, and a cross can say, I won't. A cross is found where two ways meet, and a cross can be your destination. A cross can say, you're in, and a cross can say, you're out. There are times when you're glad to see a cross, and there are times when you're not. A cross can stand for hatred, and a cross can signify love. For some, a cross is filled with superstition, and for others, it's just another religious symbol. A cross can be a warning sign, and a cross can be a sign of help. There are crosses that make you smile, crosses for sadness and loss, and crosses for remembrance. A cross can be so many different things. There is one cross that stands apart, the cross where God's own Son gave His life.
One day, we'll get to raise our hands in His presence. You know, when Solomon was king, God had blessed him abundantly, and his throne and his city and his throne room and his wisdom and all of these things was of such magnitude, people would travel long distances just to behold. If you remember, the Queen of Sheba traveled from Ethiopia to behold His throne. And she says, I don't believe what I hear, so I'm going to go see for my eyes and prove everybody wrong. But when she got there, she realized that what she heard was not magnificent enough.
But I say that to say this. When we see the throne of God, it's going to be beyond anything we can imagine. What a great day that's going to be. We're going to see God. What a great day. Stephen Siss sees God at his throne. Man. And we're going to be reunited one day because of the man on that cross right there. Amen. That one was free. It don't cost you anything. Take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 13. All right. Matthew chapter 13. Matthew's gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew chapter 13. Last Sunday, I shared with you what my New Year's resolution is. My resolution as we begin the new year of 2023 is that I find fresh fire. Fresh fire within my soul. To find a fresh fire, a renewed burning, a renewed yearning for God and for whatever His will and plan is for my life personally. To find a fresh fire for God's will for me and for God's will for you, Salem Baptist Church. And so God began speaking a message series to my heart that about that very thing. And as I prayed about it, God just took my mind and my heart to a very familiar passage. It's an unusual passage of Scripture to be as the foundation for a message series about finding fresh fire, but it's a good passage. And as we study it, we also see that God is using it to create fresh fire within our soul. It's in Matthew chapter 13. Let's read it beginning in verse 1. The Bible says, on the same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the sea. That's the Sea of Galilee. And great multitudes were gathered together to him. So he got into a boat and sat, and the whole multitude stood on shore. So there were so many people, he got out of a boat and pushed out a little bit so he could be heard by everyone. And when he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. Some seed fell on stony places where they did not have much earth. They immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth, but when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Some fell among thorns, and as the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good ground. It yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. This is a very famous parable of the sower and the seed. Now, for this parable, Jesus gives us a clear explanation of what it means. You remember, a parable is an earthly story about a heavenly truth. And most of the time, Jesus would just speak in parables, but occasionally, he would explain the parable spiritually, how to apply it spiritually, and he explains this parable, how we are to understand it. Well, let's look at his explanation of this parable. Verse 18 of chapter 13. It says, therefore, hear the parable of the sower. In other words, I'm about to explain it to you. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the wicked one comes and snatches away what is sown in his heart. This is he who receives seed by the wayside. But he who received the seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation and persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. Now he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word. But the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he who receives seed on good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Okay, as I said, Jesus gives us the clear meaning and the clear purpose of this parable. It's easy to see what Jesus is talking about. It's easy to apply the spiritual application here. He's talking about spreading the gospel. The seed is the gospel message, and he's telling us how and who will receive it. But yet, with this same passage, in addition to its obvious meaning, God is also giving us a formula, the recipe for finding fresh fire within our soul. And that's going to be the focus of our message series, Finding Fresh Fire. Now, last week, we began our series with ingredient number one, message number one, a determined desire. Ingredient number one for finding fresh fire in your soul is that you must have a determined desire for it. Let's recall. Look at verses 18 and 19. Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom but does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who received the seed by the wayside. The first example given to us by Jesus is a person, for instance, who will come to church. They hear the gospel message while they're worshiping inside the church, but before they can get their car out of the parking lot, they've already forgotten what was said. Somehow, the devil immediately snatches from their mind, snatches from their heart what was said, and it has no effect whatsoever on their life. Now, why do you suppose that is? How could they forget so quickly? It is because they never had any desire in their heart to receive it. They heard what was said, but it went in one ear and out the other. There was nothing in their heart desiring to hear the word of the Lord. Therefore, this is what we learn. In order to find a fresh fire within our soul for this new year, we must understand that the first ingredient is desire. We must long for it. We must crave it. We must thirst for it. We must desire it. If we do not, there will be no fire within us. Fire begins with desire, all right? A determined desire for it. Desire is ingredient number one. Well, today we're going to identify ingredient number two for fresh fire. After a determined desire is birthed in our heart, then comes number two, the rooted word. A fresh desire, then a rooted word. Let's go back to verse 5 and 6 when the parable was first given. Jesus says, in the second example, some fell on stony places where they did not have much earth, and they immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched because they had no root. They withered away. All right, drop down to verse 20 and 21 to get the explanation. Jesus says, but he who received the seed on stony places, this second example, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet because he has no root in himself, he only endures for a little while, because when tribulation and persecution arises of the word, immediately he stumbles. So the second example that Jesus gives us in this parable is a person who, like the first person, also comes to church. They, like the first person, also hear the gospel message being shared, but they're different. This second person is different because this second person actually likes what they hear. They even receive it with joy and excitement. They say, yes, I want to be a follower of Jesus Christ. They leave happy with their decision. It's still on their mind. They wake up the next day. They're still happy because of the decision and the experience they had in God's house the day before. But as life trudges on, they realize it's not easy being a follower of Jesus Christ. Satan begins bombarding them with discouragement. One attack after another, they become discouraged. They become discouraged because most likely their decision that they made was merely an emotional decision anyway. Most likely they weren't genuinely born again. They liked what they heard. They felt the excitement in the room. They went along with their feelings, but because they have no root, because they have no foundation built on the Word of God, because they're biblically illiterate, they fall away. When the excitement subsides and the path of Christianity becomes a difficult path, they no longer follow Christ because they have no root in God's Word as a foundation for their life. Now think about that. Think about the day and time that we live. Church, COVID is not the only pandemic sweeping our nation today. There's another epidemic sweeping across America. It's called the epidemic of biblical illiteracy. America has ignored and forgotten the Word of God. I was reading an article just this week in the Baptist Press, and they were talking about this very thing. Let me just quote or read to you a portion of the article. The article says, we are living in a post-Christian culture that is rapidly becoming an anti-Christian culture, said Robert Stewart of New Orleans Baptist Seminary. People are still fascinated with Jesus, but are biblically illiterate, and thus they're easily led astray without even knowing it. Often, American Christians are not only unable to defend the Christian faith from skeptical challenges, but even unable to articulate their own faith. Therefore, we desperately need training in Christian apologetics. Christian apologetics, by the way, means being able to say why you believe what you believe. That's what apologetics is, giving an explanation for the hope that you possess. America, in today's America, not only are non-churchgoers biblically illiterate, but unfortunately and sadly, many Christians are also biblically illiterate. And so in order to find a fresh fire within our soul, we must have a determined desire, yes, but we must also have a rooted word. In other words, we must be deeply rooted into the Word of God, because with no root, you have no anchor for the storms of life. Remember Jesus' words. He says, therefore, whoever hears these words of mine and does what I say, that person is like a wise man who's building a house. He digs down deep. He lays his foundation on solid rock, because the storms come, the winds blow, the rains fall, and they beat on that house, but that house is not even shaken because it's well built on the rock. But whoever hears these words of mine and does not do them, he's like a foolish man who built his house on sinking sand, because the storms came and beat on that house, and that house was completely destroyed because there was no anchor. Church, for a fresh fire in our soul, we must be deeply rooted in the Word of God. Without a deep-rooted foundation in God's Word, you will fall. Your family will fall. Your legacy will fall. Oh, you may seem successful for a season in the eyes of some, but it's only temporary, because without the foundation of God's Word in your life, you will fall. Now, why is that so? I mean, how does God's Word give us strength? How do we anchor ourselves in the Word of God? Well, listen to what the Bible says about itself. I'm going to have several of these scriptures, and Corey will have them on a screen for us. This is the first thing the Bible says about itself. Number one, it is God's Word, not man's Word. That's how it's an anchor for our soul, because it's God's Word, not man's Word. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. 2 Timothy chapter 3, it's God's Word, not man's Word. 1 Peter says, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. You see, it's God's Word, not man's Word. Number two, God's Word is true for all generations. Isaiah says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of God stands forever. God's Word is true for all generations. Matthew 24 says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. God's Word is true for all, for generations, for your great-grandmother and your great-grandson. God's Word, number three, is food for the soul. It feeds our soul. Even Job knew this in his troubles. Job said in Job 23, I have treasured the words of his mouth more than necessary food, because God's Word is food for the soul. The psalmist writes this, how sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. God's Word is food for the soul. Number four, the Bible is written to bring us to God. In Romans, Paul writes, for whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we, through the patience and the comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. And that hope is in God, because God's Word brings us to God. John records, these things I've written to you. In other words, he's saying, these things I've written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name. Because the Bible was written to bring us to God. But church, not only does God's word written to bring us to God, but it was written to keep us with God. Just as it says, that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. The purposeful study of God's word, by studying it, by reading it, it will actually keep us in close communion with the Lord. It keeps us close to His side. Because remember our parable when we started this morning. Because he has no root, when tribulation arises, he immediately stumbles. The rooted word brings us to God, but it also keeps us with God because it keeps us from stumbling along the way. This is how we find fresh fire. We ingest his word. We intake his word. We root ourselves in the Word of God. Let me ask you, do you feel dry? Do you feel like you're drifting? Do you feel like sometimes God is a million miles away? This is how you draw near. You get in His Word. You drink in His Word, and then He wells up in our soul. In order to find fresh fire, we must have a determined desire and the rooted word. But church, guess what else the word of God is? Not only is it our foundation, but it's also our weapon. It's our weapon against the evil one. Be reminded of Ephesians chapter 6. It'll be on the screen for you. It says this, therefore take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Church, the Bible is our only weapon against the evil one. Our Bible is our weapon. Now don't ever forget how powerful our enemy is. Our enemy is powerful. Satan could squash us with his little finger. We could never resist the devil at all in our own power. Our enemy is too big. Our enemy is too powerful for us to defeat alone. Don't ever forget that. But also don't ever forget this. He who is in me is greater than he who is in the world. We may be no match for our enemy, but our enemy is no match for God. Satan himself trembles in the presence of God Almighty. And one day every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah and amen. And though we may be no match for our enemy, our enemy is no match for the weapon that God has placed in our care, the Word of God. And thinking of that, our weapon, we're going to finish out our time today reminding ourselves of that fact. We have a weapon that renders even Satan himself is powerless. We're no match for the devil, but God's given us a weapon that will render him powerless. And we're going to look at the example given to us through none other than Jesus himself. I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 4 to the temptation of Jesus Christ. We're going to look at the very temptation of Jesus Christ and see the weapon that he pulls. And we're going to discover he's given us the same weapon. Through this historical encounter, and believe me, this really did happen. This is true history that unfolded. Through this historical encounter of Jesus' temptation from the devil, we're actually, by looking at his story, we're going to learn two very important things about ourselves. By reading his story, we're going to learn two important things about ourselves. We're going to learn, number one, our weakness, and we're going to learn, number two, our strength. All right? Now, first, the story of Jesus' temptation teaches us our weakness. Our weaknesses are, as will be revealed in this story, our weaknesses are our flesh, our fame, and our faith. Our flesh, our fame, and our faith. You see, Satan will always attack us in our weakest spot. And we learn from the temptation of Jesus what our weakest spots are. They are our flesh, our fame, and our faith. But next, we also learn our strength. You see, we have a weapon that renders Satan powerless. And he will flee from us whenever we pull our weapon. He will flee. Our weapon is the Word of God. You see, God has given us his weapon, and he's got a big weapon. Satan cowers at God's weapon. We have a license to carry, all right? And it's a license to carry God's weapon, amen? Don't raise your hands, but how many of you got a license to carry? I'll raise mine. I got one. Y'all remember the story I've told you before about the little old lady that got stopped for speeding, and she had a gun permit. And so she gave the officer her license and her gun permit. And the officer says, well, thank you for that. Do you have any weapons on you? She says, yes, sir, I've got a 38 in my glove box. Got a 9mm under my seat. And I got a 30-06 in the back trunk. And I got ammo for all of it. And the officer says, my goodness, ma'am, that's a lot of firepower. What are you afraid of? She said, not a cotton-picking thing. We got a big weapon. God has given us His weapon. And we learn through this story our weakness. Our weaknesses are our flesh, our fame, our faith, but we learn our strength. Our strength is our weapon. And our weapon is the Word of God. Three times Satan specifically tempted Jesus to sin in this story. But his temptations actually reveal our weaknesses. And three times Jesus defeated Satan with his weapon. And we have the same weapon. As we're about to read, Satan's first temptation will always be in, number one, our flesh. Let's read chapter 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now, when the tempter came to him, he says, If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. But Jesus answered and says, it is written, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Church, our enemy will stop at nothing to separate us from God. He will do anything he can to make sure he severs our relationship with God Almighty, to make sure he puts a wedge between us and the Lord. So, in order to do that, he will tempt us in our weakest spot so that we will sin, because sin creates that separation from God. Sin always separates us from God. That's why we must confess our sins every day. But the good news is, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But Satan will attack us in our weakest spot to create this division, this wedge between us and God. And so our weakest spot that he'll attack us in is through the desires of our flesh. We are born with this inner craving. It's an inner craving to satisfy the desires of our flesh. If it feels good, we want it. We don't have to learn that. We're born with it. We have to learn how not to do that, not how to do that. So Satan will point his biggest temptations directly at the part of us into gratifying the desires of the flesh. That's exactly what happened here with Jesus. Now, let's recall this temptation of Jesus. If you remember, Jesus is coming off a spiritual high point in his life. He had just been baptized. And this baptism was the starter's pistol to mark his ministry as he began his 3-year ministry on this earth, and then he was crucified at the end of that. And so you can read about his baptism in the last verses there of Matthew chapter 3. Then we transition to Matthew chapter 4, and it's the temptation of Jesus. Satan came to tempt Jesus immediately after a spiritual high point in his life. You know what? That's how the devil operates. He tries to catch you right after some spiritual high point in your life. Maybe it's when you got saved. Maybe it's when you were baptized. Maybe it's when you rededicated your life. Maybe it's at some point right after you made a New Year's resolution. And the devil comes at your weakest point to sever that relationship. Remember Jesus' warning in our parable. Some seed fell on stony ground and it sprang up quickly, but because there was no root, it fell away. Satan will come and attack you right after a spiritual success, and he will attack you at your weakest spot, which oftentimes is those natural cravings to gratify the desires of our flesh. We see this with the temptation of Jesus. Jesus was fully God, yes, but remember, Jesus is also fully man. He is God encapsulated in the flesh of man. Therefore, because he had flesh, Jesus had the same cravings that each of us have in our flesh. So Jesus was tempted in all points of the flesh, yet he sinned not. So after 40 days of fasting, Jesus was hungry. Very, very hungry. 40 days. Man, I'm hungry after 40 minutes. Amen. And while Jesus was still fasting, and in a moment of exceeding hunger, Satan tempted him to turn those stones into bread. If you've ever been to Israel, like we've had the opportunity to go, this wilderness, it was rocky. It's like the surface of the moon. And there would be rocks there that were brown and smooth, and they looked like bread. And Satan tempted Jesus to turn those stones into bread. You know what? He could have done it. But he did not. So how did he withstand? He's hungry in his flesh. 40 days, he's hungry. How did he withstand the devil's temptation? He pulled out his gun. And he hit him with the word of God. Jesus quoted Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. He says, "Devil, it is written, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." It is written, bam, the devil was gone. Jesus did not sin and the devil fled. But as you know, Satan came back later trying to tempt Jesus again. With his second temptation, we see our second weakness. Number two, our fame. Let's just pick up in verse 5 where we left off. "Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set Jesus on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone.' Jesus said to him, 'It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God.'" Now this temptation was a supernatural temptation. Satan somehow, supernaturally, Satan and Jesus supernaturally went to the top of the temple in Jerusalem. Now it was a massive structure, a massive temple with exceedingly tall structures. Satan took Jesus supernaturally to the highest point of the temple and tempted Jesus to jump off because he knew Jesus would have landed safely on his feet. Now, I find it interesting that Satan, in his craftiness, tried to use the word of God against Jesus. Satan quoted scripture here, and he quoted Psalm 91 about not dashing Jesus' feet against a stone. And he took it completely out of context, corrupting its true meaning. But that's how Satan always does. He takes God's word completely out of context to use it for some selfish motivation. You see, if the devil can't convince you to ignore the word of God, he will tempt you to corrupt the word of God. Here, Satan is tempting Jesus with the same thing that's inside of every human. He's tempting Jesus with a desire to be accepted and honored. You see, we all want to be accepted, don't we? If we had our preference, we would all want to be honored by society. How many lives have been destroyed searching for fame? And so, Satan began to tempt Jesus by tempting him to jump off this highest part of the temple because he would have come down and landed on his feet amongst the crowd of people that was there. And they would have seen him land safely on his feet. And they would have been taken aback by this. And then they would have come to him and made him famous, trying to make him their king, trying to make him their ruler. But that's not why Jesus came into the world the first time.
He didn't come into this world to receive fame. He came in the world to obey his Father. He came in the world to die as a Lamb of God. So Jesus did not take the bait. He did not sin with his temptation. And Jesus once again brandished his weapon, the Word of God. And so Jesus quoted this time Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16. He says, "It is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." It is written, bam, the devil was gone. Jesus did not sin, and the devil fled. Well, as you know, Satan returned a third time with one more temptation. This time, Satan didn't even try to veil what his purpose was. He tried to persuade Jesus. Now, think about this. He tried to persuade Jesus to bow down and worship him. You see, that's what the devil's always wanted. He's wanted to be worshiped. That's why he got kicked out of heaven. He wanted to be like the Most High. And through this third temptation, we learn that Satan will attack us in our third weakness, which is number three, our faith. Let's just continue to finish the story out in verse 8. "Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain this time and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, 'All these things I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me.' And Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve.' Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him." Satan offered to Jesus all the kingdoms of the world if Jesus would have bowed down and worshiped the devil. I mean, that's beyond our comprehension that the devil would be so brazen. But that just shows the corruption of his heart. Now, how could the devil offer all the kingdoms and their glory to Jesus? Because the devil was in charge of the nations of the world. You see, the devil's not in hell. That's mythology. The devil's not in hell. The devil doesn't want to go to hell. He ain't ruling in hell. He doesn't want to go because when he's in hell, he's going to be there for punishment. He's in the world. And he's influencing the nations of the world to corrupt the people of the world, to turn their back against the holy God. And he's good at his job. He's even caused America to turn her back on Almighty God. And so his temptation against Jesus is the same temptation that he cast upon us, to change our faith from God to anything else. He tempts us to transfer our faith in ourselves, in our money, in our charisma, in some man, in some sociological ideology. Cast your faith on anything other than God. That's what Satan is tempting to do. But once again, Jesus pulled his weapon on the devil, the Word of God. Once again, Jesus quoted Scripture. This time, he quoted Deuteronomy 6, verse 13. He says, "Devil, it is written, you shall worship the Lord God, and him only shall you serve." Church, three times Satan attacked Jesus with temptation. He attacked with the temptation of his flesh. He attacked with the temptation of his fame. He attacked with the temptation of his faith. But three times Jesus pulled his weapon on the devil. Three times he says, "It is written. It is written. It is written." And Satan fled each time. Therefore, church, this is what we learn. For a fresh fire in our soul, we must be deeply rooted in the Word of God. Without a deep-rooted foundation into God's Word, you will fall. Your family will fall. Your legacy will fall. You may be successful for a moment in the eyes of man, but it will all be gone. Because everything in this world will be gone. Though heaven and earth pass away, my words never pass away. And with no root in your life, you may spring up, but you will wither away. we must be rooted. For fresh fire, we must put our nose in this book. We must have a daily quiet time with the Lord. We must read it. We must learn it. We must meditate on it. We must memorize it. We must recall it. It's the only weapon we have against an enemy that is much stronger than us. But with this weapon, he will run away like a little girl. What about you? Are you reading this book? Are you putting this in your heart? Are you building a foundation? Are you teaching your children the Word of God? Are you building a foundation in their life? Train up a child in the way they should go, and when they're old, they won't depart from it. Build the foundation. I'm looking for a fresh fire in my soul this new year to rekindle the fires of my heart, and it will be found by reading the Word of God. And the devil don't like it that I'm telling you this. And he's coming after me, and he's coming after you. But, oh Lord, that he would hide us under his wing, and we'll poke that sucker with his word. Amen. The Word of God will always bring you into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Is he your Savior? Is he your Savior? If you read this book, he will draw you to him. Is he your Savior? If he's not, I challenge you to make that decision before it's eternally too late. Maybe your New Year's resolution needs to be, you'll start studying more. You'll start reading more. You'll have conversations about it with your family. That's a good topic to talk about, isn't it? Forget about what Fox News says. Let's talk about what the Father says. You'll change your life if you let him. Stand with me, church. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to grab a mic back here, Courtney.